Good morning, Per. How are you doing today?
Good morning, Maciek. I'm doing fine. How are you?
How is life in Sweden?
Life in Sweden is pretty good, but we don't have Oktoberfest. Rumors say that you were in Munich this week enjoying the fabulous Oktoberfest.
Oktoberfest is it's really a fantastic event. As I wrote in my post the other day, I continue to be amazed. First time I went to Oktoberfest in the year 2000, so a long, long, long time ago. And ever since, so that was 25 years since I've been to Oktoberfest for the first time, and I've been to Oktoberfest every year ever since I started. I'm amazed by the fun people have. I'm amazed by the atmosphere. It's an atmosphere of like a rock concert. And yes, a lot of people drink beer and eat a lot of interesting food, the Bavarian food. But what is really amazing, and I experienced that every year ever since I moved to Munich and I lived in Munich and I've been going to Oktoberfest. This is probably the only place in the world, especially now, where everybody is just simply friendly to each other, Per.
Nice. We need more of those places.
Yes. So, like people bump into each other. They how it is. When you get a couple of beers or something, you bump to another person. I've never seen a fight or people like getting angry because they crashed into each other, at Oktoberfest. I've seen it in other places. And remember, there's like 400,000 people every day visiting the place. That's
Nice.
crowds, total drunk crowds, and there are no fights. And the police is relaxed and everybody is happy. It's unbelievable and amazing. And I will go next year. My friends hopefully will not forget about me. So to all my friends that invite me every year for Oktoberfest, keep inviting me because I love to go there.
Beautiful. I love that.
Okay. Speaking about good relationships, today we wanted to talk about, how when you transition from a reseller or from VAR to MSP, how does it impact your customer relationship? Or maybe in other words, what should we do to make the right transition for your customer relationship? Right?
Yeah, exactly. And in our previous episode, we talked about the change of culture and how to make that happen and how hard it can be. And now we're going to talk about how are you going to take care of your customers in a better way than previously. And it's exciting because it's a great opportunity.
No, it is going to be helpful and exciting. And I think you and I, when we prepared for this discussion, I think our assumption and our recommendation for those of you who want to start the transition to the super profitable and way more, collaborative or strategic model, business model from reseller to MSP, that you should be starting this journey with your best customers. So there are three reasons I think that we came up with that we wanted to share with you.
Yeah, and it really makes sense to start with your best customers. Sometimes people can be shy and say that let's test with our not so good customers because we can afford losing them. But your best customers are the ones that will give you the best advice for how to make this a big success. And it is often so that the person that is the account manager in smaller companies tends to be the CEO, which is in fact often the owner of the company.
Absolutely. And think about this, if you would like to acquire new customers and put with a new customer something that you're only developing at the moment, because even if you use the best consultants and the best support and the best examples of whatever another MSP company, this is still going to be a new opportunity, a new territory for you. So I would assume that as the owner, as the CEO of the reseller of a VAR, you have a couple of those customers that have been with you for ages, and you really want to make sure that they are really treated the best. And MSP contract, effectively, in the end of the day, it's going to be the best offer that you are going to have. So it really makes sense to approach them with a very open message. Look, I want to transition with you to a new type of a relationship, like an ongoing relationship. We want to restructure it a little bit. It's going to be a bumpy road because it's a testing ground for me as well. It's not going to be a new service that is going to be delivered. It's going to be delivered in a much different way, much more positive from the customer point of view. But there will be a bumpy road to get there. So if you have a really, really good customer that you have a great relationship with, then you can approach him and create a testing ground for you and for your company, a learning opportunity. And at the end of the day, this best customer will become, again, the what Per likes to call the lighthouse deals.
Yeah, exactly. The deals that will be beacons of light, that will show your organization what can be done. And it will inspire other customers, and it will inspire your organization to do more deals in the same direction. So lighthouse deals are super important.
There will be the template. They will become the template, the learning opportunity. They will become the example, the success story, for sure success story. Because when you personally handle this kind of a relationship and you personally discuss with the customers, with your friend customer, you will make sure that at the end of the day, this relationship will continue to be successful, and chances that you are going to lose this kind of a best customer during the transitions are, frankly saying, minimal. Per and I believe that actually you are going to deliver a better service, better opportunities, and a better relationship with your existing customers than it was in the past.
Yeah, so, and it is the start. It is likely going to be the start of a more strategic journey together with your customers, an ongoing relationship instead of phoning them every 3 years that now it's time to refresh.
Correct. So start with your best customers, because I think we believe it makes sense, and we believe that that's going to pave the road to overall success and to transition your other customers and also potentially acquire new customers as you're continuing on this journey. This journey is not going to be a short journey, as we mentioned many times. I'm speaking with several partners right now. Per and I, we spoke with one partner in the US. It took him 4 years. Another friend of mine, it took him 6 years to do the transition. It's not an easy exercise, but they both are super happy and will be willing to share their stories in one of the future podcasts with us.
And as long as you show progress quarter by quarter, you will be encouraged to continue this journey.
That is very correct. So, what does it mean, you know, to shift your relationship? And it's a bit of a busy slide, but you need to understand that we are shifting to the recurring service-oriented relationship. And in our previous podcast, we did describe this kind of a SKU mentality to SLA mentality. And from my conversations with, I've been at the Oktoberfest, but I also met with a couple of resellers from the Munich area that are currently still resellers and are really interested in the transformation and transition to the MSP model. Breaking away from this SKU mentality, this one-time, you know, transactional mindset, it's super, super, super difficult.
And if you are focused on always do new transactions, then you will be heavy on that. But when you are a successful MSP, you are going to focus on taking care of your customers, taking care of the service that you provide, and you will be more leaning towards nurturing and taking care of caring for your customers, which means that you can shift your resources. You can spend more money on taking care of existing customers than hunt for new ones. And that's a brilliant transition.
Absolutely. And we listed, you know, a couple of kind of a topics or talking points for you, you know, how to approach this. So in a VAR approach, every cell is it's a one-time exercise. It's a project. In some of the conversations that I had, people would tell me, yes, I have a framework agreement, and this framework agreement is like MSP. Framework agreements are not an actual MSP model. Framework agreement is still, you know, just an easier way to quote your SKUs, your hours that you are charging for, but it's not an ongoing, this is not an evergreen contract. This is not a, you know, ongoing continuous engagement. It's basically a more of a, it's a better way than individual transactions, individual project, but it's a framework for projects as opposed to an SLA model. Okay, so you are with a subscription, with the MSP approach, you are delivering a complete service, an insurance policy to your customer rather than an individual transaction, and that's going to lead to a continuous engagement. When instead of, you know, closing each and every deal, you kind of meet on a regular basis, QBRs. And you keep aligning with the customer to make sure that you adjust your service level agreement as needed. You know, you make those recommendations. And we'll talk about how you make those recommendations and what are the steps that you should be taking during those QBRs.
And in this journey taking care of customers, you will try to improve your service month by month. And you will also try to optimize your cost base month by month. So as you get wiser, technology gets more mature, you are likely to both increase your margin, but also increase the level of the service that you provide to your customers. And that's brilliant. So much more fun, because customers will think that you are really the strategic company to work with. So much more fun than just selling transactions.
During those regular checkpoints and regular discussions with customers, your shift is not just away from closing the deal. It's becoming a relationship when you basically start anticipating issues. So you analyze your customer information and you start putting in front of a customer what are the challenges that you have observed in his relationship with you, and what are the problems that needs to be solved, and you know, also propose the solutions to those problems, propose the adjustments to your service level agreement, to your contract, to make those solutions, to make those issues go away. You then have a lot of data about your customer, and you start offering insights into how the customer can optimize their operations, what are the areas that could improve, and then you are becoming a business advisor to the customer, not just a delivery of a product or service, one-time delivery of the product or service.
And it is not salespeople that should have this ongoing connection, having quarterly business reviews. It is people that are delivery managers or some kind of account managers, but not focused on sales. And by having a consultative approach, by talking to the customers about their problems, you will automatically see opportunities to suggest new services that will increase the benefits for customers, but also increase your revenue. So it is a nice opportunity to have constant contact with your customers, because that is an opportunity to increase revenue and increase business efficiencies at your customer side.
The name that I've many times heard is the customer success representative or customer success
beautiful manager. Name.
The way you're moving away from a sales guy, you move into an organization that is basically analyzing the customer situation and prepares tailored offerings, you know, like, and this is a very interesting conversation I had with one of the resellers. He said, like, yes, but, you know, there are many companies, many consulting companies that offer like a one-size-fits-all approach to transition to MSP, and I don't want to become one of the many MSP like companies that offer exactly the same thing and there's no differentiation. And my response to that was, look, the idea is that when you become an MSP and when you do the proper transition, you are actually able to offer more tailored offering, personalized, hyper-personalized, and you know, the everything is moving to hyper-personalization nowadays. You're going to be offering the personal advice and personal recommendations based on your structure. So you will have maybe the delivery model that is optimized, but it could be optimized for a personalization, for a tailored offerings for each and every customer, because you will be strengthening your customer understanding when working with the customer through those QBRs and interaction and analysis and insights into their business. So that is going to completely change your relationship with the customer from kind of a one-time refresh cycle approach to a more of a strategic advisor and strategic consultant and strategic support for the customer.
And if your people that are caring for customer success have special knowledge about a certain vertical, then that is knowledge that your customers will love. So it makes sense to try to differentiate by specializing on certain verticals, or at least understand certain verticals, because that will give you and the customer a better conversation.
That is correct. You know, acquiring a specialization either in a certain vertical or certain geography could be another, you know, approach. You know, you become the support center for your town, your district, county, I don't know, your area, or you become a center of support for the hospitality industry, I don't know, healthcare industry, etc. You will start finding, you know, themes and patterns where you can optimize and then become a specialist or rather the strategic advisor in a certain area of your expertise.
Yes, indeed. And like, you don't want to be vanilla. You don't want to be one of several thousands MSPs doing the same thing. So that is the task for every business, probably every business also outside tech, that you need to differentiate in order to stand out and to become successful.
So, as we said, you know, like, you will be moving to a different approach. We spoke about changing the culture, but changing the culture internally is only one element of this transition or transformation. Your ultimate exercise will be to change the way you collaborate with a customer, where closing the deal is not a goal anymore. Customer success representative is going to be your core objective. You will be very much focused on outcomes, you know, like making sure that you look at the outcomes for the customers, regularly check on those outcomes and goals, check with the customers the challenges metrics to ensure that you are on the same page and you are continuously delivering and increasing the value that is available for the customers, for the money that he's paying for the SLA.
So when you have a mindset that you are talking about forever customers, then it is the start of the journey when you get ink on the paper when you have closed the deal. So you need to be really heavy on making sure that the customer is happy. And the flip side on that is that when you do that, well, you don't need to sell new transactions. You don't need to sell new agreements because your customers are happy and they are most likely going to grow together with you, which increases revenue per customer when you do it right.
Yes, if your goal is not to close the deal, if your deal is evergreen and you need to continuously improve it and optimize it, it's a completely different relationship and it a completely different discussion with the customer. You move from kind of a vendor and delivery kind of a partner to a strategic partner, where your position within the customer grows, within the customer, you know, organization grows immensely, okay, and increase this kind of a loyalty and retention of the collaboration. Again, evergreen deal. So you close the business, you close the deal. It's now an ongoing deal and a customer forever, which is a complete change in the approach, and helps you to also optimize your delivery model, increasing your own margin from the relationship.
Yes. So that is also a mindset that your customers will love, because they knew what was happening before, that this posh sales guy with his Mercedes black suit came. He was really super nice. And when he closed the deal, well, he was kind of on his way to the next customer. So this is so different, and something that a customer will appreciate, that it is different.
And the result at the end of this will be not only the better relationship with the customer, but think about all the referrals that you're going to get. Again, your customers will be going to those industry events, you know, like hospitality events or, you know, healthcare events, and they'll be spreading your brand. They'll be spreading the news about your joint success. Or they will be sitting, you know, for a beer at the Oktoberfest and talking to their friends. They'll be recommending your services to others, and then that will build your reputation and their reputation as a great collaboration that everybody will be willing to leverage in the future. It's not going to be about, I was able to buy this at the best price possible, or the kind of a service, one-time service that I have received was really good. It's going to be a conversation about, I have an ongoing relationship that is helping me to continuously improve my operations, and I have a peace of mind, stable revenue model, stable cost model based on OPEX. I mean, that's the best from the financial point of view. That's the best from the outcomes, business outcome point of view, and from the productivity point of view, because your customers is not going to be spending so much time on the continuous negotiation.
And then you're touching, we agree that it is super important to have happy customers, because they will brag about the success, and that will give you more business. That also means that it is wise to be willing to overinvest in a customer relationship, because it is worth so much. And if you are going to service this customer for the coming 100 years, well, then it doesn't matter if you spend a little bit of extra time getting them up and running in the best way possibly. So don't be shy overinvesting at the beginning of the journey together with your customers. It will pay off for the coming 100 years.
Absolutely. And you know what the result will be, right? Like we spoke in our, I think, last presentation and the one before, at the end of the day, everything will turn into a massive valuation increase for your company, because, you know, whoever will be looking at the value of your company, whether it's a private equity or, you know, potential merger partner, collaboration partner, they will be looking at, you know, how much business you do through this, you know, managed services or private cloud or this kind of a SLA based collaboration, and you will see that, you know, the resale business valuation is only 15 cents on the dollar. So I always say, you know, if you are running a 10 million euro organization, if you want to retire and sell your company, $1.5 million, so 1.5 million euros that you're going to get probably from the PE, from the buyer. Right now, and the source is pretty good because it's coming from the ConnectWise. If you have moved to those SLA-based approaches, then your valuation could soar to 9 or 10 times more that you are getting here. And it's much better to sell off your company at 15 million euros than 1.5 million euros.
So like what you're saying is that it is camping compared to Ritz-Carlton.
What?
Yeah, I mean that
it's
that
compared to Ritz-Carlton.
Yes. So and it's also currency. A high valuation makes it easier to buy other businesses without being severely diluted. So a high valuation is good even if you're not going to sell in the near future. It gives you the power to merge with other companies without losing the majority of shares.
Better access to capital is generally great and beneficial for everyone. And I think it also comes from like better credit terms, you know, like more reliability, you know, in collaboration with your distribution partners, with your vendors, and et cetera, et cetera. They'll see you as a more reliable, stable partner overall because of your evergreen contracts with customers. And the resellers that made the transition, you know, they are slowly shutting down the resale business completely. They moved from 10% MSA to MSP to 10% resale, and they now way more profitable and successful organizations.
Yeah, and some of the things that were part of their resale business, they repackage it. Instead of selling firewalls, they rent out firewalls together with a maintenance contract, which is effectively a managed service. So
we will start talking about, you know, how to start preparing your offers, and we will source, you know, knowledge and examples from the real resellers that reached out to us, or real MSPs that used to be resellers that reach out to us and offer their advice and recommendation. Thank you so much for joining us today. I hope that this was informative. Again, please reach out to us if you have any questions or if you want some more clarification. My LinkedIn is always open. There is a possibility to book a meeting with me for a short conversation. And I'm always happy to join you guys. And next week, I'm not going to be available because I'm going to go to B2SMB conference. And in 2 weeks, I have been invited to the Lenovo Tech World. So our next conversation will probably happen in 3 weeks from now.
Yeah. And that sounds great. And dear listeners, if you think that what we are saying doesn't make sense, please reach out, because we also like to learn from you about the things that you have tried in the past and that has not been working. And perhaps we can help you with some advice that will ensure success when you try again.
Correct. Thank you so much, and speak to you soon.